Hey everyone, so much to talk about and discuss and look at. So let's just get started, okay? So I think in my last video or the one before that, I talked about the newest cross stitcher magazine with that PhD pattern, and a wonderful viewer of mine, Chantal, used to get the subscription and stopped paying for it, and they magically sent her that copy of Cross Stitcher, and she said that she didn't want it and that she would send it to me. And I'm so grateful. Thank you so much. So, anyways, she sent this to me. So I just thought that I would flip through this for y'all really fast, or flip to the patterns that I am interested in. There's a few more in here that I'm interested in than I thought there would be, so that was pretty exciting. Let's see. And I'm sorry, my phone is catching up. So I don't know personally if I will ever do this one. This is also by Emma Congdon, but this matches two of her other patterns and that she's come out with for Valentine's Day. And they're very, very similar, but I do like it. This is the work in progress, and it says, I'm working on my PhD in cross stitch. And then in parentheses, it says projects half done, which, funny story that I'll get into in just a little bit. But this is the pattern, and this is what I really wanted this magazine for. It's so gorgeous, and it's not that big. It's only 6.5 by 5.5. So it's so adorable. So that's mainly the one that I really want to stitch out of this for sure. And then let's see. There was a few more in here. I also really like this pattern. This is by Maria Diaz, and it says, Sail Away With Me. I was in the sorority Tri Sigma, and our symbol was sailboats. So I think this would be really cute, but instead of in blues, to do it in purple, because our colors were purple and white. So I actually really want to do this one for my sorority. I also really like this little cacti. I think it is incredibly adorable. I don't know if I would ever make it into a pincushion like they did here, but I would totally stitch it up like this and put it in a really cute, like, teal frame or something to put on my desk at work, because I work in a cubicle and keeping plants alive in a cubicle is sometimes really hard. I'm trying to remember if there was another one towards the end or not. I can't remember. I don't think so. No. So I am really excited for those couple of smaller projects, especially the PhD one. Also, in her package to me, I got this really adorable little postcard that she wrote, Enjoy the Magazine. And it's so cute with the little kitty cat. And she surprised me with two Gentle Art limited edition. I'm assuming is the name is limited edition. I don't know as much about general arts. The only time that I've ever used them have been in a frosted pumpkin kit, so I'm not quite sure. But they're a really beautiful variegated blue. Very, very pretty. And I've PM'd her since I received it. I got it really quickly, and it came from a different country. I think she sent it, I don't know, it came within like 4 days, because I believe she sent it on Friday, and I got it on like Tuesday. So it was a really, really quick trip for this. So thank you again so much, Chantal. I really appreciate it. And yeah, so excited. Another thing that I wanted to show really fast is my last project for January, and it was to work on Halloween Town. And I didn't get as much done as I was hoping or thought that I would, and a lot of that is because I worked on it Monday and Tuesday, and they were working on the tile Monday through Wednesday, and there was just like the first 2 days were especially like really loud, and like they were going in and out, and like it was just a lot. So I mostly stitched at nighttime, a little bit during the day, but mostly at night. But I did get some done. I got the rest of the bottom finished on the one side over here. And I did change the skull to white just because I liked it more. I got the frame and the wording finished. And I did a little bit of work up at the top. So not a whole lot, but I did get some finished, but I will be excited whenever this does get finished, because I really do like the pattern. It's really cute. All right. The next thing is a pattern I was talking about, really wanting a temperature blanket, but I just can't crochet anymore. I learned as a little kid, and then I tried relearning a couple years ago, and I just couldn't keep the tension because of my hands, and that's only gotten a little bit worse, which doesn't really bother me, except I just think they're really pretty. So maybe one day, but I saw, you know, people are doing like the continuous box for the temperature, or they're doing the bookmark. And then I saw the flowers pattern in, somebody had mentioned it, I believe, in the Stitch Mania group, and they had a group for it on Facebook, found the pattern, but I really liked the idea of the flowers, but I personally don't really like the circular. And someone had mentioned, Sarah, had mentioned that she was going to create a temperature garden. So she did, and this is the pattern. I'm going to show it like really far away, but, it basically has like a row and says January. It has little flowers and the petals are the days, then February next to it, March, April, May, June, all the way down to December. It's really, really adorable. I bought it on her Etsy. Her Etsy is Stitchin Mommy, and I will put that down in the description. Stitchin Mommy on Etsy. Temperature garden pattern. She also has some other patterns on there that you should check out. She has a State of Maryland with the Maryland flag in it, which was really cool. And she has a Texas with the Texas flag in it. And she has a couple other states, California, Colorado, I believe, and for some reason I want to say Ohio, but I'm not quite sure if that's correct or not. But you get a pattern of instruction, you get a picture with the download, it's $10 US. You get a picture of like an example of one completed. You get an example page, and then you get three different patterns. And on the last page, There's three different temperature gauges. So one's a cooler range. So if you live like in Alaska, where more of your days go into like the negatives, and like your hottest day is only up to like 80s or something like that, she has a range for that. She has one that's more of like a varied temperature range. And then she has one for hotter regions that don't get very cold like ever. So I think I'm trying to remember, it started around like 25 or 30 degrees. And I'm talking degrees Fahrenheit. I don't know the Celsius. It's on there. She has Fahrenheit and Celsius, but I just don't. That was math a very long time ago. And that one goes up to like 120 or something like that. I'm going to use my own temperature gauge that I came up with at the beginning of the year whenever I started recording the average temperatures for each day, just for like shits and giggles. I'm going to use mine that I created with the space out of temperatures that I wanted. But you do have those three different temperature gauge options with the DMC and... Does it just have DMC? I honestly don't remember. I didn't print that page out because I didn't need that page for me. But that is available. It's a really, really pretty pattern. You should check it out. All right. So let's get down to the fun part of this video. Let's talk about the giveaway. So I just want to re-show what the winner's going to get. The winner is Dana, and I hope that I'm saying your name right, but Dana won. And if you went on my Instagram today around 12 p.m. Central Time, I posted a video. So as everyone entered, I put their name, their Instagram handle, and their question to me in a table in Excel, and then I did a rand column and a rank column. And if you don't know what I do for my job for TDCJ, which is the Department of Criminal Justice for Texas, is I teach computer classes, mostly Excel. And so I did a rand, which is random number, formula in the rand column. And then I made a rank formula in the rank column, which put the random numbers, because they're like 0.00 blah 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 decimals, in a rank order. And I shuffled them a lot, because like any time that you change the anytime you do anything to the document, like typing wise or anything like that, or pasting, the rand will shift. So I shuffled it a whole bunch, and then you can see in my video, I wanted the final shift to be on my favorite number, which is 7. So I typed in the numbers 1 through 6, and then I copied, and then whenever I pasted the rank by value, or the rand by value, that was the 7th final shuffle, and it can no longer be shuffled once you paste value. And that's how I found my winner. I thought that was going to be the fairest way, because I talked to and know so many of you that entered. So that was going to be my fairest way, other than drawing names out of a hat. That's basically how you draw names out of a hat in Excel. So I just wanted it to be really fair. So just as a reminder as to what you're going to get, you are going to get a 5-inch spring tension hoop, a 7.25-inch spring tension hoop, which is my favorite size, and I use it all the time. Currently working on my giant Harry Potter, and that's what I'm using. These are my favorite in life. You're going to get a Christmas-themed kit, 2 Halloween-themed kits, a packet of Bowen 26 needle, the Frosted Pumpkin Fibery Friends Sampler Pattern. 2 hand-dyed skeins of floss from me, the Dyed Panda. And a 12 by 18, 16 count, traditional styled spiral tie-dyed piece of Aida from the Dyed Panda. So it came out really good. I really like it. I hope you do. Sorry it's a little wrinkly, but I can't get to my iron right now because 3 of my bedrooms are, well, 2 of them are empty and 1 of them is filled with 3 bedrooms worth of stuff. And my Texas surprise for you, I picked up this Made in Texas, a really cute wooden Texas magnet from the town that I am in. So that is the package. Congratulations, Dana. I will be mailing it to you tomorrow. The reason why I wanted people to, and I mentioned this in my last video, but the reason why I wanted you to tell me the project that you're most excited about this year was, one, for me to find out about more patterns and designers and to find out just about more things, because I don't know about all of them. I know about Hades and I'm a little terrified to start those, but we'll get into that. But I mostly stitch clouds, frosted pumpkins, stitch Rovia, Satsuma Street, and a few random things here and there. But that's pretty much what I stitch. I've heard of like Lakeside and things like that, by being in Stitch Mania. I've heard of some of the others that are really popular. They just aren't my style personally, but everyone's style is so different, so I wanted to find out about even more designers and patterns and things like that. Leave it alone. He's playing. Stop. Stop. Potter. All right. He's kind of cute in the frame, and then I can see what he's doing. Stop it. All right. Your questions, which I have right here, were also so that way I could answer them, because a lot of you had really good answers. You can't have answers. It's my life. A lot of you had really good questions for me, and I could have answered you in the comments, but some of them I figured would be really good, and so I thought it would be kind of fun to answer them in this video announcing the winner. So I'm just going to kind of go down the list, and yeah. All right, so the first question is, have I ever stitched with silks? And no, I have not. I mostly have to get, I've never been to an L&S. I've ordered from an L&S down in Houston, and my dad has picked it up for me, and she's also shipped stuff to me, but I have never tried them, and I don't really know, I don't really have access to them where I'm at. We're having a meetup, by the way, on February 11th, 2017, at 1 p.m., if you are in the Houston area or can drive to the Houston area and want to drive to the Houston area, there is going to be a Stitchers meetup at ABC Stitch Therapy. I believe that's what it's called. So if you're coming to that, I know some of you are coming to that, which is really cool. Can't wait to meet y'all. But other people, you're welcome to come. Just letting you know. But I may look at silks. I don't really know the ins and outs of them. Like, if, I mean, do you have to do a project only in silks? Can you mix it in? I don't really know. So, but no, I have not stitched with silks before. No. I have done, oh, what's it called? It's a type of embroidery. That might have been with silks. what was it called? It was like Brazilian. That I think might have been with silks where you make like these little like twisted flowers and stuff. That might have been with silk. So I might have worked with, I might have in embroidery now that I think about it. Possibly with like ribbons and silks, I think. If I think we did like Brazilian embroidery and that's what it is, it's like specialty stitches, then yes, but never with cross stitch. So I'm not 100% sure actually. The next question was, what is your favorite pattern to work with? I really don't know. I've been cross stitching since I was about 4, and I used to do like smaller kits whenever I was a kid. And you know, I just don't like kits really anymore. I don't really think I ever did, but back in the early 90s, you know, like I'm talking like 90, 91. The patterns, obviously there wasn't the internet, at least not to like average people. So this wasn't a thing like where you could like buy a pattern and like kit it yourself unless you bought like gazillions of books. And that wasn't, we weren't those kind of stitchers in my family, okay? So we didn't have that kind of stuff. So we bought kits from like Walmart, Michaels, Crafts, etc. back in the day, Hobby Lobby, Joann's. That kind of stuff. And whenever I kind of got back into stitching was whenever I discovered Stitcherovia on Etsy. And so I have a bunch of her patterns. Then I discovered Frosted Pumpkin and got really into the Frosted Pumpkin. So I think I was writing down my whips today, which I'll get into that too in just a minute. But majority of my whips are Stitcherovia and Frosted Pumpkin, so in Satsuma Street. So I guess I'm kind of more in that vibe. I'm more into like the kawaii looking people and animals with the Frosted Pumpkin. I really love the typography of Stitcherovia, and I really like the bright, bold colors and geometric shapes making up other things of Satsuma Street. So that's probably, I would say, would be like my favorite patterns to do at this point. My next question is, have you been to the place with the 3-pound cinnamon roll? And I kind of answered this on her Facebook. So if you don't ever watch the Food Network channel or anything like that. A couple of different people, I think Man vs. Food has been there, and the guy, his name is Guy, and he drives the red car, Diners, Dives, and Drive-Ins. They've all been to this place. It's in San Antonio. I have not been because it kind of exploded in popularity because of those shows. So I didn't know about it all the times growing up. And I don't really know if it was even around whenever I was going growing up. But I haven't been to San Antonio in probably, I don't know, like 9 years maybe? 8, 9 years? No, way longer than that because my mom was with me. At least 10 years. So, I definitely have not been, but I know what you're talking about. There is a place that has a 3-pound cinnamon roll. It's literally massive and just coated in frosting. My next question is, do you have everything planned you want to stitch for this year? And, I made a video at the end of November, early December about my planner, going through my planner for 2017. And I actually, to be honest, as of today, like today, I reworked some of my calendar and I filled in all of the blank spots between now and September. And I have some patterns already filled out for October to December, but I have the first nine, well, January's over. I have the next 8 months planned. Like things are all obviously subject to change. I already filmed my plans for February and I changed my calendar. I don't want to say drastically, but I did change some of the patterns that I was going to work on in February and I think March, April, and definitely for May for Stitch Mania. I changed up some patterns. So what I said that I was going to be doing in my plans video for February, some of those are not even going to come out whenever I do my updates. So yes, I do have it planned. And I'll talk more about why I changed some of my stuff with one of the questions farther down. It has to do with whips. I keep on saying that in this video, but a lot of it has to do with that. So, but yes, I definitely do. The next question is, what is my favorite frosted pumpkin pattern, done or not done? And honestly, let's see. My favorite pattern, like ever, I will say that my favorite border pattern with a border has got to be the Happily Ever After. I'm loving the floral border. It's gorgeous. But one of my favorites is my Tea Time. I loved that pattern. I stitched it on Picture This Plus Midas, which is a gold fabric. But I would have to say that's probably my favorite. And I think it's mainly because it has, like, I love French macaroons. I love the coconut ones too, but I really like French macaroons, but I love tea. So I don't, there's something about that pattern. I love how dainty it looks. But I don't, there's just something about it. I absolutely love that. I love how the teacup looks like very old, beautiful, rosed china. Yeah, and I love the colors of it. Pinks and golds and bright blues. It's just a really pretty pattern. It was called Tea Time. How many days a week do you stitch? I try to stitch every single day. I have every single day in my planner marked with a pattern to be working on, and or a theme from the Stitch Mania group on Facebook. So I attempt to stitch every single day. Some days it doesn't happen either because I don't feel good, I just run out of time and I'm too tired, or I have the full intentions of sitting here and working on something because this is where I stitch. But I just get enthralled in something on the TV or I don't know. Just for whatever reason. It doesn't always happen, but I try to stitch every day. Have I found the panda chart by Soda Stitch? No, I haven't. I haven't looked, but I do remember that it's by Soda Stitch, and I'm going to look for it. I'm trying so hard not to, like, go and keep buying stuff. The only thing so far that I bought Stitchy-related this month was the temperature garden pattern, but I have been wanting to find a temperature pattern for cross stitch since last month, and I knew that one was coming out, and I liked the way that it looked, so I went ahead and spent the $10 for that PDF, and then I spent the $2.15 for the second part of the Stitcherovia charity with Mind UK Quotes to Live By pattern. So I'm trying to kind of take a page out of your book and only like give myself an allowance of how much I can spend each month. And I know that I'm going to the LNS on the 11th. So maybe it'll be there and I can get it, or I might be able to find it online. but I do remember the who it's by and that it's Panda. So I will look for it whenever I decide to put that in my budget. But yours came out really, really cute, Adele. My next question is a favorite thing to stitch in my history. I really enjoyed, obviously, the tea time. I really think that's one of my all-time favorites to have stitched, actually. I just really, really like that one. Do I prefer stitching day or night? It's not really, I can stitch any time of the day, to be honest. It doesn't really matter to me. On weekends, depending on what's going on, I'll stitch literally all day into the night. Sometimes on the weekends, I have plans in the evening, so I'll stitch during the day or in the morning. But during the weekdays, I work a normal 8 to 5, so I only have the option of evenings. So basically, whenever I have a chance to stitch, I do it. I don't really have a particular time period. I don't rely on like sunlight or anything. So it's really just whenever I want to or have the opportunity to. I even sometimes take it to work and stitch on my lunch break. So I am definitely not opposed to just stitching wherever, whenever. I have an official question from Helga Marie for the giveaway, but she has also been asking me a bunch of questions on Instagram. So I kind of put her Instagram questions and her entry question in here. So her Instagram questions were tension hoops, does the frame indent the fabric, and do I leave them on a project? Also, she asked me about my rotation and how do I decide what to stitch and any advice. And her official question for the giveaway was, do I ever abandon a project and move on? If so, what do I do about it or what do I do with it? So the first one, the spring tension hoop, I don't have a needle in here right now, so I'll go ahead and I just placed this, but that's okay. So it does leave circular indentions just like a traditional hoop, but I mean, I've moved it around. I mean, you can see where it's been recently. Certain patterns I will leave a hoop in. I tend to leave a hoop in my Harry Potter one, and that's mostly because it's such a big pattern. I mean, it's 1 foot by 3 foot, and it's so many colors. It's like 60 or something colors, and for me, that's a lot. I know anybody that does a hay, that's nothing, but for me, that's a lot. So for that one, I tend to leave something. If I have a pattern, because I have a bunch of spring tension hoops, like there's another one on my table, but I have several of them. So if it's a month where I'm going to work on a pattern for like the first week and then I'm going to work on the same pattern later in the month, I will probably leave the hoop on there. Occasionally, I accidentally do leave the hoop on a pattern and put it back in its bag. I just don't think about it, and I may not pull that pattern out again for months, and I've been looking for that hoop for months. It does happen, but not as often. I usually remember, especially since starting FlossTube, I do remember to take them off because I'm showing them after I'm done working on them for the month. So I remember to take them off whenever I'm showing them, and then I put them straight back into their bag. So, but I do. I definitely do on the Harry Potter because it's in its own bag. It kind of lives in its own world. And if I take it anywhere, I want to make sure that I have a hoop and not have to remember that. I also have like a pair of scissors in that bag. I don't always use that pair. depending on, you know, I want to always make sure there is a pair, and I always have a needle minder in the bag with it too, just because there's just so many working parts to that one. That's definitely my biggest piece as of right now. As far as the rotation, I know we've been texting and I've been telling you about this, but being a part of Stitch Mania, I look in the events and I kind of talk about it. I know that I told you to watch my planning video, and you said that it confused you more. So maybe I can explain a little bit better. In the Stitch Mania group, they're in under the events. They have, you know, events for each month that are like themed, and it's supposed to be fun to wear if you want to join. It's definitely not a have to. But every month this year, there's a featured Stitcher theme. So like, one of the months I think is like Soda Stitch or something, and I just don't have any Soda Stitch patterns. So one of the months is, I'm trying to think, Mirabilia. If you want that whole month, you would work on nothing but Soda Stitch if you wanted. If you want to join the new start on the 17th every month, that's up to you. If you want to do the color a day every month on the 15th for the birthstones, that's up to you. So I kind of plan my rotations, I guess, with some of those themes. So this month, one of the monthly themes was Fandom February. And a fandom is things like Harry Potter or Hunger Games or, you know, like a fandom. So I decided that I wanted to join that one. And then I think about the patterns that I either already have as a whip or that I've been wanting to start, and I work on that pattern. So that's kind of how I work in my whips and stuff. So it just depends. I went through the entire event list for the year, and I picked out the ones that seemed the most interesting to me as like a theme. And the themes really, I mean, I'm not religious about posting photos and stuff in Stitch Mania or on the particular event pages for each month in Stitch Mania or any of the groups for that matter. I'm more religious about FlossTube and my Instagram on posting photos of my stuff. So I don't really do it for that, or to really be like, hey, we're all working on this month. I don't really do it for that. I do it more to kind of give me a direction on which whips to pull out of my pile to get work done on them. Because if I didn't use some of these already, like somebody put together these events, just as like a springboard idea, you know, I basically do it for that. And I try to, depending on the event, and whenever I hear it, if I already kind of have like a pattern in mind, I try to think on how many days in a row would I really want to stitch that. And so, you know, I kind of figure out how many days I would want to work on something. And then I also factor in if I am going to join any SALs. And then the farther the year goes out, I left a bunch of blank spots, but I'm slowly filling those in. And from what we've talked about with whips and things like that, which I found out today that I currently have 28 whips, and that includes my SALs. I currently have 28 whips, and by the end of the year, if I do not finish anything, I will have 51 to 52 whips if I don't finish anything. So that number kind of freaked me out, so it kind of changed how many new starts I was doing, and I kind of changed some of the patterns for some of the themes that they still worked, but they weren't all like new starts and stuff. So some of them were smaller patterns. So our conversation with that has really helped me rethink some of my planning for this year, because that is a really big number, but I know that I'll get finishes, so I'm not so worried about it. But that's kind of how I rotate. But the best advice is if you don't want like a big WIP number, or if you think your WIP number is too big, if you're doing SALs, my best advice for anybody is if you're doing SALs and having a high WIP number really kind of freaks you out, every month, just do your SALs first. So like you get, if you're doing quotes to live by, do that SAL for however many days it takes you to get caught up. If you're doing Frosted Pumpkin, same thing, Clouds Factory. And then the rest of the month, pick up one of your WIPs, whichever one you want to work on at the time, and think that you'll like work on it till it's finished, because that's also my problem. I have ADD and I like to move around a lot. So just pick one and work on it till it's done. And if you finish before the end of the month, before your SAL new pattern comes out, then pick up another one. And if you run out of time for that month before your SALs come out, put that one down, do your SALs, and then pick that one back up if you're still into it. I like to function differently, but I totally understand where that comes from. Your last question is, do I ever abandon a project and move on? If so, what do I do with it? I actually abandoned Clouds Factory's postcards last year. I just got really tired and discouraged with it. It's still kitted. Don't get me wrong. I'll eventually finish it. I have it slated to work on in like October, because I really just don't want to see it until then, to be quite honest. But I have it slated to work on in October to finally get it finished. But I don't know. I mean, I may get to October and I may not want to work on it anymore. So I know it will eventually get finished, but how quickly, I'm not really sure. There are a few other pieces that I started a long time ago that have been put down for literally years. I know where they are. They're in my bin, but I don't, you know, I honestly, a few, like one or two of them, I don't know if I'll ever pick them up again. And they were kits. And I think that's why I haven't really picked them back up. But I might. I don't know. They're still there. I mean, I don't throw them away or anything. I've given one away. I don't know. What I would eventually do with them. What is my favorite DMC number? I kind of really like white or B5200 because I like to dye some of my own, but I don't really have like a favorite number, although 601 bright pink is really pretty. But I really like all the bright colors. Like the really bright colors that like what Donna Stitch uses in her like Disney fairy princess line. I really like the bright colors. If I had a Texas friend or family move, would I stitch them a Texas piece? If yes, which one? You know, I don't really have many friends. I mean, I have lots of friends that have moved, but that I'm close enough still with to make them something, probably not. If it was like a really, really close, like, I want you to be like my bridesmaid type thing friend, maybe. And if I stitch them anything, it would probably be something like really small. There's a pattern and I don't know who it's by. It's just on Etsy and there's several people that have it, but it's just the outline of Texas and it has the love in it with the O as a heart. I would do something like really super simple, for someone. That's what I would do. Just like the outline with love in it. That's probably what I would do. But I haven't ever stitched anybody something like that. I'd be more likely to make something Texas for myself. I mean, honest. Do I have any hobbies outside of stitching? I do. For my 30th birthday back in October, we went and painted pottery. I did that a lot as a kid. I like to go with, I like to go to painting classes. I go to, what is it called? I go to Pino's Palette a lot. And I've done several paintings for at Pino's Palette. I've painted wine glasses before, and actually they used to sell in a shop here in town. I used to make jewelry. I quilt. I don't quilt my quilts. I make the tops. What else? I grew up being very crafty. I was in Girl Scouts for 10 years, so I was literally always doing crafts. I used to make, like, friendship bracelets. Like, I've poured terrazzo. I've designed and poured terrazzo. The Snoopy. Oh, where am I going? The Snoopy right there. I designed and poured the terrazzo for that. Yeah, I have a pretty crafty streak. I really want to attempt stained glass, but it's really expensive. And I've actually looked into the classes and where it's located. I wouldn't be able to make it to the classes in time for my work. So I have yet to do that because it's about 40 miles away from where I live, but classes start like at 6, and even if I left work on time, if there was a wreck or any traffic, I would not make it, and that's a lot of money to possibly not make it on time. So yeah, I like doing a lot of different things. Let's see. How long have I dyed fabrics, and have I run into any issues with dye running when I wash a completed project? I'm not going to lie, I don't wash my completed projects. I never have, and I probably never will. I mean, unless, like, for some random reason, I absolutely find it necessary. But that's not something, like, I grew up doing this, and, like, my mom taught me how to do it. My grandmother used to do it. And none of them ever did. So I didn't even know that was a thing until about 4 years ago. So old habits die hard. So I've never done it. So honestly, I don't know. I know that whenever I dye my fabrics, I rinse them out until the water coming out is clear. So I assume that they are fine. But I've never washed my fabrics. I've been dyeing fabrics. Oh man. For stitching about a year. I occasionally like tea dyed throughout the years, but like dyeing like different colors, about a year. Tea dyeing and coffee dyeing for a long time. And I've been tie dyeing like shirts and sheets and socks since I was a kid. So I've always had an interest in dyeing fabrics of any kind. And it just kind of started coming into my cross stitching. Do I like to park? And if so, was it easy to pick up on? I don't do full coverage pieces really. So I've actually never parked. I've wondered this exact same thing myself. Is it easy? But I don't do full coverage. So for the most part, it's not really worth parking for the types of patterns that I generally do. So that is something that I'm actually also very curious about. And it's something that if I ever dive into starting a Haid, I would want to know more about. That's one that I do not know how to answer. Do I enjoy cooking and what is my go-to meal? I love to cook, bake, and grill. Yes, I can grill a steak. And if it's over medium rare, it's cooked too much. That's just awful. Why do you want to kill the cow so much? I have a master's in animal science, so I like it with a little moo left in it. But I do love cooking and baking and all of that. And right now, my go-to meal is actually the Snappy Kitchen video that I posted last month, the Greek chicken pasta. I have literally eaten it every single week, at least, you know, like while there was leftovers, which is usually like 4 days. I've literally eaten it so much. It's at least like 4 days of my food every week for the last like month and a half. So if you haven't tried it, you should. It's really good. Do I have furry stitching buddies? I do. My more predominant one is Potter. And that's because he's sleeping right now. Right there. Potter. He's more predominant. He likes being super social and he likes to lay behind me and be around me all the time. He's my 3-year-old. I also have a 17-year-old calico. Her name is Gizmo. She's been in a few videos and she's on my Instagram for sure. But she kind of likes to be left alone. She's kind of getting more social a little bit, but she really likes to just be left alone. And I have a 17-year-old dog named Haley, and she's primarily an outside dog, and she only comes in at bedtime because she is really old, and that's just what she's used to. But she also just isn't really all about being in your business. So she just likes to come in and she lays down. I have some pretty boring pets. I mean, they're awesome, but they aren't, like, they don't want to be always on top of you. At least two of them don't. Potter always wants to be around, usually, unless he's sleeping. Have I ever thought about dyeing thread more regularly? I have, and if you're on my Dyed Panda, I have some colors that I know for sure I can replicate at this point. I don't know if I'm to the point of just dyeing stuff and posting it for sale, like that set, that is for sale, as is. I don't know if I'm to that point yet. I want to get to that point, to be honest, because I really do enjoy dyeing fabric. But I just don't know how much people like my style of dyeing. I really like doing the traditional style of tie-dyeing, and I like the traditional tie-dye look on Aida fabric, but I have been doing some custom pieces, which there are photos of those on my Dyed Panda Facebook site, so you should check those out. But I do custom pieces for people on Aida, and I don't do linen or even weave or any of that because it's just not available in my area. For me to get. Only Aida is. So that's what I'm stuck with. And I know that that loses me some people who want to try out my style. But I don't know. I want to do it. I haven't yet. Maybe this year. Have I ever tried 5D diamond painting? Whenever I saw this question, I Googled it because I had no idea what you were talking about. It looks really, really cool. But no, I've never tried it. I honestly don't know if I have the patience for it. It's basically full coverage. And it's kind of like paint by numbers, but with like tiny Swarovski crystals in all different colors. But like paint by numbers with all these little tiny, and like you place them on this like sticky paper It's really, really cool looking, but I think if I'm going to do something that full coverage and it looks rather time consuming in the video, I watched a YouTube on it. I think I would probably step into an actual haid before I would deal with that because I think I would lose my patience really quickly with doing little tiny tweezers and little crystals. And I'm pretty girly, but that's a little bit too much bling for me personally, but it is really cool looking. So kudos for anyone who does that. If I ever did it, I would probably do like a really small piece, but the ones that I was seeing are huge. So if it was like really small, maybe, but no. And this girl was talking about how many hours it took her just to do like 10 squares. It was like hours. I would rather take the time to stitch, honestly, but that's me. But it does look really cool. My favorite piece I've ever stitched, again, would be the Tea Time by the Frosted Pumpkin, I think. I really, really liked that one. Am I planning on joining the Insects SAL by Lakeside Needlecraft? You know, some of the newer SALs that don't show you any previews, I don't ever join them. I like to at least see one bit of it before I decide, to be quite honest. I haven't seen a preview of it yet, at least not as of right now. So I'm going to go with no, because I don't know what it looks like. I do know about their other ones, and I like the one that's like the mythical creatures, but I don't like all of the squares. Like, I really like the mermaid and the unicorn, but I don't really like any of the other ones. So I don't know. I just don't think that their style of patterns are really my thing. But that mermaid is really cute. Like, I would do just the mermaid circle, but I don't think I have that option. I think I have to buy the whole year, and I don't want the whole year. I just want the mermaid. So I don't know. Maybe if I see more of the pattern, I'm not ruling it out, but I do like to see at least a part of a pattern before deciding. Does anyone else in my family stitch? My mom used to stitch. My mom has passed away. But I used to cross stitch with my mom, and her mom used to stitch and embroidery, and she also used to crochet. My great grandmother used to crochet, and that's who actually, my great grandmother's who taught me whenever I was like 7, the first time. My dad's girlfriend embroidered me some placemats for my kitchen table years ago, but that was her first project in years, and she hasn't done any projects since. There might be, my family up north, my family in Maryland, some of them do, not religiously, or they used to, and they don't anymore. My great aunt Anne, though, she still, sews and crochets. But I don't think she does any like stitching, like embroidery or cross stitch anymore, but she used to. And my cousin Cheryl has been working on a cross stitch for like 5 years now. It's supposed to be for me. I'll never get it, by the way. She had a birthday gift for me and was in my town at Christmas and forgot to come by. And then was back in my town a couple months ago and forgot to bring it back to my dad's. So it's just stuck in my hometown at one of her family members' houses that I don't know. And she doesn't come down very often. 1 year at Christmas, we got 8 years worth of Christmas photos from her.
She's a very good procrastinator. So, yeah, there are some people, and my great grandmother who passed away in the 70s before I was even born. She used to sew and embroider and all that, and I had a great aunt that died whenever I was a kid who used to. So, I mean, there have been people, but still around, very, very, very few. Very few. Can I share more about my adorable dogs? My dog Scout, who is on a lot of my Instagram from a year ago, passed. I had to put her down in December of 2015. So she was the black lab who, there's a lot of photos of her and my white cat Potter cuddling. But my dog that lives with me right now is my 17-year-old Haley. And I'll try to share more whenever I'm filming. If she's inside, I'll try to, but she's going deaf. So it kind of like startles her whenever you like wake her up if she is laying down and sleeping. So I don't really like to do it very much. But if she is up and walking around and I'm filming, I will make sure that she comes in the frame like I did the last time she was up and walking around. But yeah, I just don't like disturbing her too much. She is deaf. Or going deaf, like she can hear only certain pitches. So she hears like really like loud, high pitched things, and if like movement will like make her get up. But she sleeps on the other side of this table on a dog bed, usually cuddled with Potter. So I don't always like to disturb her, but I will try, and I'll try to get her on my Instagram more for you. She is quite a cute dog. What is my biggest finished project, and can I show it, and can I show my red work piece at my dad's? I will insert a photo of my project, my biggest finished project at this point in time. If I ever finish the giant Harry Potter, it'll be that one. But my largest finished project at this time is Clouds Factory Zodiac SAL. Love, love it. I'll insert a picture. I will also insert a picture of my red work that I mentioned. I messaged my dad and he took a photo of it for me and sent it to me. So right now I'll put those two photos. All right. The next question is, how did I start my FlossTube, and was it ever intimidating to film myself for YouTube, and is it less so now? I started it kind of because kind of like everybody was doing it, it seemed. And I had had a YouTube, well, it's the same YouTube channel, but I had other videos on my YouTube, and I took them all down and just started it over and did mostly FlossTube. I've done some like makeup hauls and some other random things. And I'm still going to probably put some of those kind of random videos like makeup hauls and stuff, which I haven't done one in a long time, and I have a lot of makeup to do a haul. Mostly by Tarte, by the way, favorite company at the moment. But I kind of really just started it because I heard about it on Stitch Mania, obviously. And I watched a few, and I was just like, this is so awesome that we are getting online and filming ourselves and showing what we're working on and showing our progress. And not only that, I mean, it's just another way of keeping track of what you've worked on, when you did stuff, and just sharing it. I think it's just really fun. It's also kind of like me asking what's your favorite project that you're looking forward to this year. It exposes you to so many patterns. And one of my favorite ones to watch, and a part of it is also because we've done personal swaps, but I just love her work. But Davina, if you're watching this, or Mamala, I know I'm not saying it right. I'm saying it how it's like spelled out, but she pronounces it different. Davina does a lot of hades. And one of my all time, like if I ever decide to delve into it, I would probably do Old World Map. She's working on that one. And it's just so much fun each month to see these like insane hades that are just huge. Just slowly, and she's such a fast stitcher, guys. It is so cool to see her progress because she is such a fast stitcher. Can you tell that she's like one of my favorites to watch? But it's just really, really cool to see. She stitches so fast that each month it's like it just all starts coming together. It's insane. It's so cool. But I loved the exposure to different patterns, and I learned about different fabric companies that way, and thread companies, and designers, and it's just really cool. And you just we had done some personal swaps because of craft swapping, Davina and I, and so like we had, you know, like chatted a bunch and stuff like that, but then starting to watch her videos, it's kind of like you're getting to know the person a little bit more with each video, and it's just fun. And another person that I really enjoy watching is Adele. Thank you for entering yourself into this giveaway. But she also stitches really fast. She gets so many finishes. And there was a lot of things that I've learned from her, like tips and tricks. And it's fun. It's a really fun community. And I teach. Like, my job is standing up in front of a classroom of people. Not always. I mean, I'm at a computer desk, but sometimes I get up and walk around. But I stand up in front of people and teach them how to use the computer. So why not? And I've had to teach classes in high school because I was a TA. I've had to do it in college getting my master's. We had to, you know, do some classes where we taught undergrad classes for part of our grades and things like that. So I've kind of always put myself in those kind of positions, but this time a camera's at me. And clearly I always have a lot to say. So I just thought it would be like a fun outlet for me. And so that's kind of just how it like started. I just watched some other people's and I was like, I could do that. I want to do that. And so I just did it. And sometimes it is intimidating because I'm not always great with words. And I know that I've probably made a few people upset with how I've worded things before. And that's never been my intention. I'm just really blunt and sarcastic. My humor is a little bit drier. It's a little bit kind of on the like if you had to compare it to anybody's humor style, it's probably more like a drier, hysterical British comedy show in real life. And in real life, I'm incredibly perverted. I was raised with mostly boys, so my mind's usually, like somebody can say something very innocent and I just giggle. I just giggle. Like, they did it to me today at work. Somebody said something and I go, and I just couldn't stop laughing. And I just kept on repeating the one word. And my boss was like, it's time to go home. Just go home. And like, that's just my personality. It's just who I am. So I know that I've probably said some things not meaning to come across a certain way. So sometimes it is kind of intimidating, and it still is, but at the same time, I'm being me, And I don't force anybody to sit at their house and watch me, which is why I really don't understand why there's a dislike button on any video, because I have received a few here and there, not very many, by the way, because the FlossTube community is amazing. But I've received a few here and there, and I'm just kind of like, I don't see a point. I get it. If you start watching a video and you don't like it, instead of just giving it a thumbs down, why not just turn it off? That's kind of my opinion with anything. If I just don't like it, I just don't watch it. So, but that's, you know, so it is sometimes really intimidating. You're putting yourself out there, your personality out there. Sometimes sharing a little bit too much about your personal life, but how much do you share? How much do you not share? You know, it's a balancing act. But I don't think it is less now. I mean, because I'm just gonna do me. And if you like it, you like it. And if you don't, you don't. So that's kind of where I am with that. I love doing it. And, I think everybody who watches me and who enjoys, I've been told several times in the last 2 weeks that I'm an enabler, and they blame it all on me. And, I'm like, sorry, but I don't think y'all really mind. So the last question, and this is a really long video. I'm sorry, but I just thought this would be so much fun to actually answer you guys' questions. And FYI, Michelle, did you notice I just said use guys's, not y'all? She texted me earlier and said, sometimes I forget that you're from Texas until you just texted me that your neighbor's husband is a ranch hand and you say y'all a lot in your videos. I thought it was kind of funny. But I am curious though, Michelle, where do you, whenever you forget that I'm from Texas, where do you think I'm from? Like, that's what I want to know. Like, if y'all didn't know that I was from Texas, or if you, like, forgot, where would I be from? Because whenever I was up in Maryland, this lady asked me where I was from, and I said, Texas. And she said, you don't sound like you're from Texas. And I said, oh, I do if I say certain words. And she said, oh, like, say some words. And I said, well, I mean, if I say y'all. And she goes, yeah, that's Texas. But yeah, she literally said, you don't sound like you're from there. And I said, well, you definitely sound like you're from up north. And she, yeah, it was funny. All right, so, yeah. See, he's the more interactive. Please don't lay on that. So my last question is, are my cats interested in my projects and how do I handle them stealing and their fur? So if the fur gets really bad on a project just from it like floating around, and sometimes he lays on things, but usually they're in bags. But I do keep a lint roller in my living room. So I use a lint roller. Potter will sometimes steal skeins of thread. And sometimes he'll actually steal a bobbin. And he just wants to play with it. But what he really, really likes to steal are my needle minders, loaded with needles. He loves to steal these. So before I go to bed, I have to make sure to clip them on to my frame and turn it upside down, because I used to just leave them on my table, and I have a brass, like this granite tabletop is sitting on brass legs. So it magnets itself to like the center points. And I was like, oh, he won't be. Yeah, he gets that off. So I had to start putting it on my spring tension hoop and flipping it upside down so he couldn't get it. Because one of the times he got one of the needle minders off the table and onto the dog bed, and the needle minder still had like two needles left on it, and it had five before I went to bed. And it was like in the kitchen. And because he had been like playing with and like
playing around with it. And the other needles were lodged in the dog bed. Like, they were, like, half sticking out. So that could have been disastrous. But he did steal a pair of my scissors off the table. I'm pretty sure they're underneath the couch. But whenever I sweep and stuff, I've been leaving them because I'm like, I'm just going to have to, like, re-sweep and mop after they're done doing the tile in the bedrooms. So I've kind of just, like, left them. But sometimes I did find a bobbin of thread all the way in one of my guest bedrooms whenever I was cleaning them out for the tile work. It was underneath a hope chest. And I don't even know how he got it under there, but it was under there. I'm sure there's some somewhere else. I just haven't realized it. But yeah, he stole a pair of scissors. They're probably underneath the couch that I need to get out this weekend. But for the most part, he doesn't do that very often. Gizmo, however, so I have my ORT jar. I was reaching around my computer to grab it, but my computer's sitting on top of it. Go figure. But Gizmo, my ORT jar, I've had to start putting the lid on it because she thinks that it's a cup. And any time that there is a cup sitting on a table that she thinks doesn't have a lid and that she can get whatever drink is inside out of it, or if she can tip it off or over to let it pull out so she can drink it, she will do that. And so she lately has thought my ORT jar is a cup full of drink. And so in the middle of the night, I keep on getting woken up to my plastic. And this is why it's now plastic and not glass, because 2 years ago it broke and shattered everywhere. But but that was him, not her. But I will wake up to the sound of plastic hitting the tile, and I'll come in here. And if I don't leave the lid on, she's pulled out all of my floss, but it's still in the bowl. So that's fine. Like, they don't, like, try to eat it or run around with it. They just leave it. But so I've had to start putting the lid on that. But that's really the only problems that I have with them. Fur is inevitable, but I use a lint roller for that. But that was the last question. I guess as far as handling it, I don't put everything away every night. I just make sure that my ORT jar is closed and, imagine this is actually on the frame, but I just make sure that any needle minders are attached to this, and I flip it upside down on any bobbins that I have out and my scissors. That's what I do, and they leave my stuff alone. So that's kind of how I handle it. Thank y'all so much for participating in this first giveaway. I really want to do at least one more in the year of 2017. In like a few months, probably like mid to late year. I really enjoyed this. I hope y'all did too. Thank you so much for y'all's questions. I hope that some of y'all stuck around till the end to hear the answer to your question or anyone else's. Again, thank you for all the support in watching my videos. Thank you for letting me watch your videos and sharing great content. If you can come to that meetup on February 11th in the spring area, if you're going to be around the Houston area that day, that would be fantastic, and I cannot wait to meet you. But please, anything that you heard or any questions that you heard and it was an answer on one of them that, like, I just don't know, like the parking or the silks or anything like that, leave any information down below in the comments on this video.
because somebody was genuinely asking and would like to have some advice. And on those topics, I just don't have any. So, yeah, let me know what y'all thought. And again, congratulations, Dana. It will be on its way to you, today. I'm filming this on Friday. I'm going to post it on Saturday. So it'll be on its way to you, tomorrow, real time, but video time today. So again, thank you guys, and I will see y'all all next time. Bye.